Disney's Disneyland.
When you wish upon a star, makes no difference who you are.
Each week as you enter this timeless land, one of these many worlds will open to you. Frontierland. Tall tales and true from the legendary past. Tomorrowland. Promise of things to come. Adventureland. The wonder world of nature's own realm. Fantasyland. The happiest kingdom of them all. Presenting this week from Fantasyland, the Disneyland Story. This is the Walt Disney Studio in Burbank, California. Directly over Mickey Avenue, the main thoroughfare of the studio. To all outward appearance, it's just another working day here. The actors arrive and prepare for the day's work. Kirk Douglas, Peter Lorre, Esmeralda. On stage, James Mason has already begun work, battling a 40-ton squid. On the stages nearby, other productions are afoot.
I know you. I walked with you once upon a dream. Visions are seldom all they see. But if I know you, I know what you'll do. You'll love me at once, the way you did once upon a dream.
On the surface, things here appear to be following their normal pattern. But the truth of the matter is, something unusual is going on in the studio today. Something that never happened before. Here now to tell you about it is Walt Disney.
Welcome. I guess you all know this little fella here. It's an old partnership. Mickey and I started out the first time many, many years ago. We've had a lot of our dreams come true. Now we want you to share with us our latest and greatest dream. That's it, right here. Disneyland, seen from about 2,000 feet in the air and 10 months away. I want to tell you about it because later on in the show, you'll find that Disneyland the place and Disneyland the TV show are all part of the same. Now on a site of 240 acres near the city of Anaheim, in Southern California, right about in here, we've begun to build Disneyland the place. We hope that it will be unlike anything else on this earth. A fair, an amusement park, an exhibition, a city from the Arabian Nights, metropolis from the future. In fact, a place of hopes and dreams, facts and fancy, all in one. Now, next year, our television show will be coming from this Disneyland. But this year, we want you to see and share with us the experience of building this dream into a reality. This is a quarter inch to the foot scale model of Disneyland. When you come in the main gate, past the railroad station, down the steps and across the band concert park, straight ahead lies the heartline of America, an old-fashioned Main Street. Hometown USA, just after the turn of the century. America was growing fast. Towns and villages were turning into cities.
Soon the gas light will be replaced by electricity, but that was still in the future. At this time, Little Main Street was still the most important spot in the nation, combining the color of frontier days with the oncoming excitement of the new 20th century.
Now at the foot of Main Street, about where you're sitting, is the plaza.
The plaza, or the hub, is the heart of Disneyland. Shooting out from here, like the four cardinal points of the compass, Disneyland is divided into four cardinal realms, the four different worlds from which our television shows will originate. They are Adventureland, Tomorrowland, Fantasyland, and Frontierland. Behind the gates of Frontierland is the inspirational America of the past century. Here is the treasure of our native folklore, the songs, tales, and legends of the big men who built the land.
Some of them were completely legendary, like Paul Bunyan the woodchopper with his blue ox Babe. Then again, we find that true stories about real people can be fabulous too. Now in our TV series from Frontierland, we're going to tell about these real people who became legend, like Davy Crockett, the first coonskin congressman. Now Davy's life was so fantastic that it was hard to tell where fact left off and fancy began. Now here's Norman Foster, director of the unit, who's going to shoot the story of Davy Crockett on Davy's own home grounds, the Great Smoky Mountains of Tennessee.
Well, tomorrow we push off for the Davy Crockett country. When we were back there looking for locations, I noticed a funny thing. People back there still talk about Davy. They sing songs and they tell stories that have been handed down from generation to generation. In the hearts of these people, old Davy Crockett is still very much alive. Now, we're about to shoot a little test here, and it's just as good a way as any for you to meet the young man that's going to play Davy. His name is Fess Parker. He'll tell you a little about it in a song. Ready, Fess?
Ready.
Roll them. Action.
Born on a mountaintop in Tennessee, greenest state in the land of the free, raised in the woods so's he knew every tree, killed him a bar when he was only three. Davy, Davy Crockett, king of the wild frontier, fought single-handed through the Indian War, till the Creeks was whipped and the peace was in store. And while he was handling this risky chore, made himself a legend forevermore. Davy, Davy Crockett, the man who don't know fear.
He went off to Congress and served a spell, fixing up a government and laws as well. He took over Washington, so I hear tell, and patched up a crack in the Liberty Bell.
Davy, Davy Crockett, seeing his duty clear. When he come home, his politicking done, why the Western March had just begun. So he packed his gear and his trusty gun and lit out grinning to follow the sun.
Davy, Davy Crockett, leading the pioneer.
He heard of Houston and Austin and so
to the Texas plains he just had to go.
Their freedom was a fighting another foe,
and they needed him at the Alamo. Davy, Davy Crockett, king of the wild frontier.
Our second realm is called Adventureland, the base of operations for our camera teams in almost every sector of the world. Within Adventureland is a wonder world of nature's own design, her animal creatures, her fabulous plan of life. Here, too, is a world of unusual people and faraway places. To tell about Adventureland and the stories to come from here is producer Ben Sharpstein.
At the present time, we have 30 camera crews operating in various parts of the world, filming stories for our Adventureland shows. Actually, it would be difficult to single out any one of these as being most interesting. But one that is certainly most unusual is this expedition that we have here in the Galapagos Islands, directly on the equator. Just getting there was an adventure filled with hazards. 2 men at sea for 25 days. Only 30 feet of boat to furnish transportation, living quarters, and carry supplies for a 6-month stay. On their arrival, they were greeted by a welcoming committee. And so, for Conrad Hall, the filming of the Galapagos story began before he even reached the shore. Jack Coffer, the other half of the camera team, is recording the amazing story of the giant land tortoise, putting on film the life history of a rare and all but extinct specimen. Another species peculiar to the islands is a marine iguana. The only seagoing lizard, he lives on land and feeds exclusively on seaweed. A living reminder of the age of dinosaurs, he's equally at home on land or in the water. In the Atlantic Ocean, 500 miles off the coast of South America, are the windswept, treeless Falkland Islands. Sewell Pettengill is an authority on bird life. But when he attempted to film the curious ways of the penguins, he soon found that he was the object of curiosity. A shaving mirror placed among them to divert this curiosity made matters worse. For now, the penguins had discovered the most fascinating spectacle of all, themselves. And so, it became a matter of patiently waiting until this new interest had worn itself out. To bring you unusual adventure stories from the remote corners of the globe is all a part of our plan. Here in Lapland, deep in the Arctic Circle, our photographers are filming another exciting story, the story of enormous reindeer herds and the people whose lives depend upon them. As the herds migrate from one feeding ground to another, so must the families, a people who are literally herded by their cattle. Highlight of the year is roundup time. Here is the reward of a year of hardships and hazards. Meat for the table and hides for 100 uses. The reindeer supplies all the necessities of life, plus action and drama for Adventureland. Far from the frozen tundra of Lapland are the burning sands of the Sahara. Here in Morocco, another camera team is recording another type of adventure. These are Berber tribesmen, fierce defenders of their homeland, determined guardians of their way of life. Here upon their ships of the desert are the blue men of Morocco, restless wanderers since Bible days, nomads who risk thirst and starvation for the freedom to roam. When tribesmen meet tribesmen upon an oasis, months of hardship are soon forgotten. Privation gives way to primitive expressions of pent-up emotion. These people have chosen this way of life, a life they fight to retain. However, our cameras are fortunate to record customs that have survived the ages, fortunate to have photographed another unusual story about people and places. In Portugal, our cameras are filming an unusual and exciting tradition that is very close to the hearts of the people. This is no ordinary bullfight. This is a contest that matches brute strength against human endurance.
Ha! Toro! Ha! Toro! Ha!
Apparently, the objective for the bull is to knock the men down in one clean sweep. The men, on the other hand, attempt, as a unit, to overpower the bull and render him harmless. In these encounters, the bull does not lose his life. In fact, as things turn out, the bull gets as much fun out of it as anyone else.
Hey, hey!
were only scenes from the things to come. For in the four corners of the world, 30 camera teams are filming other exciting and unusual stories. These will all become part of our Adventureland series.
Now our third realm is Tomorrowland. Ever since the invention of the bow and arrow, mankind has both worried and been fascinated by the forward march of science. Today, with the recent discovery of tremendous natural forces and their harnessing to man's use, man is still anxious, yet still hopeful. In the programs to come from Tomorrowland, we plan to explore these forces and their use, to find some measure of understanding about the things that lie before us. Here to tell you about our realm of tomorrow is director Ward Kimball.
In our new Science Factual series, we will unfold some of the latest plans our scientists have made for the coming conquest of space. For instance, we will actually show you the designing, building, and the launching of the first passenger-carrying rocket ship into outer space. Here's an exploded view of the ship showing how each of the four rocket sections will be used to blast the rocket with its 10-man crew to over 1,000 miles above the Earth. Floating high above the atmosphere, our space pioneers will face situations unknown in our present Earthbound life. We will illustrate the problems to be encountered with our own specially designed common man. Up in space, with no gravity to hold him down, he won't know which end is up. He will be absolutely weightless. It will not be easy for him to eat, to sleep, or to drink. With their mathematical calculations and rough sketches, scientific advisors have helped our artists create a brand new spacesuit. Built-in construction tools are one of its mechanical features. You will see this suit in action when we show the construction of the first atomic-powered space station. This base, floating 1,000 miles above the Earth, will be the jumping-off point for our trip around the moon. Years ago, Jules Verne wrote one of the first space stories, in which he fired his heroes to the moon from a large cannon. However, our requirements for a moon ship had to be much more modern. Here again, our scientists helped us solve the problem. After the moon trip, our next objective will be the planet Mars. When Galileo constructed the first telescope, he could see only that Mars was round and sort of reddish in color. As telescopes were improved, astronomers began to observe more and more detail on Mars. Through the centuries, many ideas have been advanced as to the possibility of life existing on Mars. Is it animal, vegetable, human, or just plain nothing at all? We won't know until we climb aboard our future atomic-powered rocket ship and see for ourselves. The future exploration of our universe and its mysteries will be one of the many adventures in Tomorrowland.
The last realm is Fantasyland. We cross the moat through Sleeping Beauty's castle into the world of imagination. Once here, we can fly with Peter Pan to Neverland, wander with Alice through Wonderland, ride Cinderella's pumpkin coach, in fact, anything your heart desires. Because in this land, hopes and dreams are all that matter. We hope that through our television shows that you will join us and take part in the building of Disneyland, and that you will find here a place of knowledge and happiness. A very favorite storyteller of ours, Uncle Remus, had another name for it. He called it a laughing place.
Of course, us had troubles before, but there ain't none of us ever had troubles like poor little Brer Rabbit. Yes, There he was.
Way down in Brill Fox's cave.
I didn't say it was your laughing, please. I said it was my laughing, please, Brer Bear.
During the last few years, we've ventured into a lot of different fields, and we've had the opportunity to meet and work with a lot of wonderful people. I only hope that we never lose sight of one thing, that it was all started by a mouse. Now, that's why I want this part of the show to belong to Mickey, because the story of Mickey is truthfully the real beginning of Disneyland. Now, that's how Mickey looks today. But I remember another time when he didn't look so prosperous. First time I met Mickey, he was a hungry-looking young mouse playing in his first movie. He was so poor that he didn't even own a pair of shoes. The picture was called Plain Crazy. Now, that was the year that Lindbergh flew the Atlantic. Maybe it was crude, but it was a start, and it led to better and better parts. Now, as Mickey began to eat regularly, naturally, his appearance began to change, too. Being only a mouse, I guess it's honest to say he enjoyed all his newfound fame. After all, he was the only mouse to ever win a personal Academy Award. But Mickey, at heart, was an unselfish little guy. He wanted to help others find a place in the limelight, too. His dog, Pluto, for instance.
Now watch. I'll show you how to do it. Like this.
Now, other young, aspiring actors joined Mickey's growing stock company. He had a couple of new proteges, a fellow they called Goofy and a loudmouthed juvenile called Duck. Mickey's faith in his two pals paid off. Donald Duck and Goofy graduated from supporting roles to stardom. Now the door had opened wide, the way was clear. And into the studio that Mickey built almost single-handed came the others. Snow White,
Dopey, Pinocchio, Bambi, Dumbo. But if Mickey thought he was getting out of grease paint, he was dead wrong. The greatest thrill of his acting career was still to come. It happened on the night of November 13, 1940, at the Broadway Theater in New York City. The same theater where he made his first appearance as a ragged, shoeless mouse almost 10 years before.
And now we're going to hear a piece of music that tells a very definite story. It's a very old story, one that goes back almost 2,000 years. A legend about a sorcerer who had an apprentice. He was a bright young lad, very anxious to learn the business. As a matter of fact, he was a little bit too bright, because he started practicing some of the boss's best magic tricks before learning how to control them.
Now, before we go, we'd like to bring you a preview presentation of some of the scenes from our next week's show. From Fantasyland, we will bring you our television version of Lewis Carroll's classic, Alice in Wonderland.
Step into a world of wonders as next week, Walt Disney brings you his musical cartoon version of Lewis Carroll's beloved story, Join Alice and meet the same delightfully wacky characters along the way as she did. Here's the White Rabbit who started the whole adventure.
I'm late. For a very important date. No time to say hello, goodbye. I'm late.
Here's the rabbit hole through which Alice fell headlong into Wonderland. And here's some of the fantastic folk Alice met in this happy, nonsensical world. And of course, the Mad Hatter and the March Hare, who invite you to the maddest tea party of all time. Adventure piles upon adventure as Alice wanders further and further into the realm of Wonderland. Here she met her gracious majesty, the Queen of Hearts.
Oh, what fireheads!
Here the famous croquet match between Alice and the Queen. The March of the Playing Cards. It's Walt Disney's musical version of the world's favorite nonsense tale, the story of Alice and her fabulous adventures in wonderful Wonderland. Coming to you next week from Disneyland.
When your heart is in your dream,
this has been an ABC Television Network presentation.